It's an honor for me to conclude the Transvalor International Simulation Days, and my talk will be focused on modeling and simulation of laser beam melting additive manufacturing process. And this work has been carried out in Cemef laboratory. So first I will do a short introduction of about what is a laser beam melting process, why we are interested in developing numerical simulation of this process. After, we'll talk about the different scale of modeling that has been so far developed in Cemef. And finally, I will draw some conclusions and the next challenges concerning this, the numerical simulation. So first, what is the laser beam melting process? So simply, we have a recoater that deposits a layer of a powder bed with control thickness. As you can see on the video, a laser selectively melts the powder bed according to predefined trajectories given by 3D CAD model. Then, after the powder bed is solidified, the support goes down to receive the next layer. And finally, by repeating, as you can see, the previous steps, we are able to obtain a 3D part. So why we are interested in this process? Because complex shapes with complex geometries are easier to manufacture with this kind of process, contrary to casting, for instance. We can decrease the duration time and the cost of complex components with for example, functionality optimized. Sorry. And this process is currently and already applied on a wide range of material, for instance, metallic with titanium or nickel superbased alloys, on ceramics, in polymers, and so on. Unfortunately, however, we know that quality and performances of parts are highly depending on the ability to control the process parameters. Indeed, we know that voids, for example, cracks or melt pool instabilities can occur during the process. And that's why the limitation of defects occurrence is essential in order to enhance good mechanical properties of the final parts. And that is the reason why it's really essential to get a better understanding of all the physical phenomena that occur during the process. For example, we know that we have large temperature, quick melting and solidification, residual stresses, or vaporization phenomena. And that's why researchers and manufacturers are really interested in developing innovative approaches based on numerical simulation tools. So first, I will talk about the macroscopic scale developed by Yongshen Zhang at Cemef. It's a simulation at the part scale, covering the whole manufacturing part. The energy and material inputs are simplified, and it represents a thermomechanical simulation. That is to say that the free flow evolution is ignored in the melt pool. So finally, we can have access, for example, to the distribution of residue or stresses during and after processing. And we can have access also to the thermal and mechanical role of the support structures during the building, inducing differential cooling condition. And we are able to predict defects such as cold cracking. So what are the main principles of the macroscale modeling? We first start with a 3D CAD model of the part completed by the substrate and also by the additional supports. Then we mesh this CAD part in a background mesh, as you can see there. We construct the conformation at the interfaces. The first one is the material and the gas one and the constructed part with the unmelted powder. Then over time, the level set function is updated layer by layer or fraction of layer by fraction of layer. Finally, by solving the thermal and mechanical problems in each time steps in the whole part And also in the unmultipolar, we can have access to the residual stresses or the occurrence of defects. So now I will just show a short simulation, a typical simulation of a turbine workpiece. As you can see there during building, it represents approximately 17 hours with 60 cores. And you can see there the surrounding powder around the workpiece. And finally, we can have access to the final temperature also in the unmelted powder and in the wall part. And after cooling, cool down to room temperature, and after removing the substrate, we can have access to the distribution of stress and to be able to predict, for example, the prediction of crack. So now I will talk about the mesoscopic modeling. That is a large part of my my PhD. So contrary to the modeling with at the macro scale, we take into account the male pool behavior, and we want to get a better understanding also of the laser matter interaction. So we use different heat sources to introduce the laser energy. We are able, because we are taking into account the male pool flow, for example, the tracks geometry, or for example, we are able to predict the occurrence of phenomena such as bowling or tearing or male pool instabilities. And we are able also to take into account, for example, hard cracking. And we can couple this with development in Cemef to be able to get the microstructure in extremely fast solidification and cooling rate. So first, also now, I will talk about the modeling of the LBM process. So mainly because we are using finite element methods, traditionally we use the level set method. So we have a distance function to track the interface between the gas and the material, that can be the melt pool, the solid, or the mushy zone. We define at the interface an EVSI function with valve thickness epsilon to be able to ensure a smooth transition of material properties around the interface. And as you can see there. And the more important thing is that the powder bed is considered as a continuum media to ensure a good CPU time cost. And the densification of the powder bed into a melt pool and after to solid is considered irreversible in the simulation. So first, we have to solve the heat transfer equation to get the temperature evolution in the whole system. So first, we introduce the laser. We consider that it follows a Gaussian distribution. Then the laser will interact mainly in two different conditions. The first one is, as we can see in the literature for welding, the interaction between the laser and the melt pool. We consider, due to the high and local absorption of energy, that the surface itself represents correctly the laser melt pool interaction. And it is converted into volume one by using the direct function. After that, due to the fact that we consider the powder bed as a continuum media, to take into account the multiple reflections that occur during the interaction, we take it into account by using a volume heat source based on Beer-Lambert law. And finally, we take into account different terms, for example, the radiation one and the vaporization one, because typically when the temperature exceeds the boiling temperature, we don't take into account the generation of metallic vapors, but we take the phase change by heat sink term. Then, to take into account the melt pool behavior, we have to solve, obviously, the Navier-Stokes equation. And due to the fact that we consider the powder bed as a continuum media, to take into account the shrinkage of the powder into melt pool, we have to consider a compressible Newtonian behavior. And we introduce different forces, as for example, the gravity, the surface tension force, that it will have tendency to bend the liquid towards the gas. After that, due to the fact that we have high temperature gradients, it generates tangential forces that is more commonly called Marangoni forces that will have a tendency, for example, for meso-and to enlarge the melt pool. After that, and these different forces are imposed both on the liquid-gas interface and the liquid-powder interface. And finally, when the vaporization stage is obtained, we have an action-reaction mechanism that is generated due to the fact that we have a high ejection of metallic vapors at high velocity. And we take into account with a force that will have tendency to be in opposition with the surface tension one. And because we solve it with the level set method, we have to track the interface after solving Navier-Stokes equation by solving a transport equation. After that, to take into account the solid mechanics, we solve the equilibrium equation, considering elastoviscoplastic model for the solid part, a viscoplastic in the mushy zone, and a Newton one for the remaining parts. And we as you can see there, we solve after that sequentially the different equations that I talked about just before. So now I will talk about some applications to a ceramic materials to see that we are able to take into account what we call boiling effect. That is to say that if we increase the velocity scan and keep the laser power constant, we are able to take into account, for example, the transition from continuous to interrupted tracks by increasing the laser's velocity speed, as you can see there. And it is something that experimentally that can be observed. Then, if we look in the distribution of stresses, we are able to see on the cross section that the high values on of sigma xx and sigma zz that generate that are responsible of risk of cracks in the perpendicular to the scanning direction, and it is something that has been observed experimentally in a work with Liliana da Silva Sancho at San Demetrio. Then I will talk about some application to metallic alloys. That is to say, for instance, a static laser shooting on a nickel superbase alloy. As you can see there on the velocity distribution and the temperature, we are able to obtain first the different stage during the process. That is to say, the shrinkage of the powder into a melt pool after the densification due to the surface tension forces. And then when the vaporization stage is obtained, the recoil pressure is applied, and finally the solidification after when the laser stops. Then we go to a single laser scan on a powder bed, still on a nickel superbased alloy. And the most important thing is that this model, if we compare it when we take the complete model and a model without vaporization phenomena, we can see that the vaporization phenomena significantly affect the melt pool morphology, and it is really important to take it into account. Then, some simulations have been developed for multiple laser scans for two materials, still the nickel superbase alloys and the titanium one, Ta64. And what we can see, it's a juxtaposition of four different tracks. And what we can see there is that the material properties have a strong influence on the melt pool morphology and after to the final bit shape, due to the liquidus temperature that are highly different and the different values of surface tension coefficient and Marangoni coefficient. And finally, what is a more original topic of my PhD is to develop multi-layers simulations That is to say that after building a single track, we deposit a new layer, and after we do again a single track simulation. And as you can see there, the code now is working correctly, and now we are doing experimental work to see if the model goes well comparing to experimental. So the main idea is to see the influence of the laser can strategies on the final shape of the bead. So finally, laser beam melting additive maturing process offers a lot of opportunities in manufacturing science and in a wide range of industrial applications, for example, medical and aeronautical, as geometry complex geometries are easier to manufacture with this kind of process. We have understood that the reduction of defects is really crucial for industrial needs and to be able to propose piece with high quality and that is the reason why it is important also to get a better understanding of all the physical phenomena that occurs during the process. And it obviously lead to the opportunity to develop numerical methods. And I have presented both macro and mesoscale that were able to demonstrate in terms of capabilities that were able to do multiple scales and configuration investigated. And also it demonstrates flexibilities because various materials have been investigated. And we are able to take into account multiple and complex physical phenomena. So so finally, one of the main challenges is to develop, for example, multi-scale simulation and strategies to be able to take into account both the track quality that can be given by the microscale simulation and the final part properties of the final part that can be given by the macroscale simulation. That's why it's a lot of things can be developed and are still really interesting about additive manufacturing modeling. Thank you for your attention.